Welcome to Weekends with Whitney. Thanks for joining us. Coming up on today's show. Find out what has these officers all revved up. Then meet the Denham Springs man who, after surviving childhood cancer, became a doctor to save the lives of other children. How they're making dreams come true together. Then Dr. Nick discusses divorce. It's something we're all touched by, directly or indirectly. He lets us know how to keep a failed marriage from ripping us into pieces. But first, see the driving force behind giving kids with cancer something big to smile about. Over the course of almost 20 years, these motorcycle law enforcement officers have used their skills to raise more than $1 million to give kids fighting cancer a day to forget all about being sick. It's fishing galore with the St. Jude Dream Day Foundation. Baton Rouge Police Corporal and President of Gulf Coast Police Motorcycle Training, Jeremy Stanley, says they wouldn't dream of not doing it. It's an inspiring day for officers too.
It's absolutely amazing. You've got kids who have been cooped up in a hospital getting treatment and can't get away. For that one day, that one weekend, they can get away, their families can get away, because it takes a toll on the families too and the friends. They can get away and do anything that they want to do, anything at all. And Dream Day does an absolutely amazing job with putting that on and having that possible for all the kids.
They raise money every day of the year for Dream Day. It culminates into a four-day event at Lamar Dixon, the Gulf Coast Motorcycle Skills Championship. More than 150 officers from across North America come to be part of it.
We had three riders come down from Canada last year. It's a hard-fought competition. But at the same time, all the officers are involved are getting a training and things that they're going to see on a daily basis on that motorcycle on the streets of wherever they patrol.
Dream Day Foundation board member Tiffany Manser says it wouldn't happen without them.
These officers in this event, the Gulf Coast Police, they just mean the world to Dream Day. We wouldn't be able to put on and raise the money and just support the children of St. Jude without organizations such as these officers who raise money for us. It's amazing that a group of officers from different agencies can really come together in the community and stay together for so long. It's really a tribute to the officers in this area.
Livingston Parish Lieutenant Donnie Robinson says they ride for something greater than themselves.
It feels good to dedicate yourself to something that's going to help children out, so why not? That's why I keep coming back. I'm not the greatest rider in the world, but there's something bigger than me out there, you know, and it's them. So that's why I continue to do it, and that's why our whole team continues to do it.
He wouldn't miss it. He always reserves the first Saturday in May to be here.
It's absolutely well worth it, no matter what. No matter how dusty it is or how loud it can be, and they want to play with the sirens, play with them. It's a really good time. If you've never been, you got to get out there and see it. It's a fantastic event.
They are definitely 100% on board with Dream Day and with our mission. More than raising money, they come out, they escort the children out to the property and spend the day with the children one-on-one. And it's really a great way to give back.
Officers from all neighboring parishes joined forces for this.
Everybody wants to be involved because ultimately the money goes to kids with cancer. If that's not something you can get involved in, then I don't know you. But all the guys, all the police officers, all the civilians that are involved, it's very close to their heart. I mean, we send a lot of kids to St. Jude. The state of Louisiana sends a lot of kids to St. Jude every year, and we want to be involved. We want to help that, and we want to help cure that one day.
They raised $100,000 last year, 40% of it selling $10 raffle tickets.
Last year, we raffled off a side-by-side. It was a big side-by-side on a trailer. This year, our grand prize in our raffle is $10,000 cash. We try to change it up every year and see what's relevant to people at the time, and we invest in it and get a return on those raffle tickets.
I threw in a raffle idea for next year.
How about a get-out-of-jail-free card?
Oh.
Now, that could be a real good item.
We could make a ton of money off of that. I'll get with the chief and let you know how that works out.
Or maybe a ticket swap of sorts.
If, you know, you all pull over any motorists, is it okay if the first thing they say is, can I buy a ticket?
I'm not going there.
Instead of getting a ticket, I want to buy a ticket.
Yeah, look, you're absolutely welcome to purchase a ticket. But, if we pull you over,
yeah,
you're getting a
citation. It's not to sell us a ticket.
No, we can't do that. No, indeed.
That's the only thing I found they wouldn't do for these kids. And by adding to their lives, it could one day help save their own. Training for competition helps them better handle what's on the streets.
Those courses are set up to simulate what you may see going down the road. You may have to weave in and out of traffic. You may have to slow your bike down to almost a crawl to get through a crowd to keep from hurting somebody. Something may fly out in front of you that you need to dodge. So we want to get everyone to get the training that goes along with it, because you're going to see this. It's just a matter of when and where. But as a motor officer, you're going to see this somewhere on the streets, a lot of this stuff. So we want them to be familiar with it here, so that whenever it happens, they can react to it and react well and hopefully save their life or save them from injury, if nothing else.
If you'd like to test your own skills, they host a civilian challenge in the spring. To see officers in action, nearly 150 will compete this fall. You can bring the whole family while helping St. Jude families too.
It's a great thing just to have your kids out for the day. It's a free event, it's open to the public. You can come out and just spend the day with your kids and just be outside.
While 800 pounds of Harley is heavy, weigh it down even more, like this, and suddenly, it's a breeze.
To have a kid on the back of your motorcycle, riding down a gravel road, them screaming with glee just for that, because that's what they wanted to do. It's absolutely amazing feeling. It's unbeatable.
I'm on top of the world.
The Gulf Coast Police Motorcycle Championship starts on Tuesday, October 17th and runs through Saturday, the 21st. It is free and open to everyone. And coming up, meet the couple who founded Dream Day, why they first invited kids to Clinton, Louisiana from all over the world, and why no dream is ever too big. Then Dr. Nick shows us how divorce doesn't have to lead to destruction. How to better navigate the landmines of a marriage ending as Weekends with Whitney continues.
You see that? That's a trash can. It's a special place where trash goes. Not here, not here, not here. Is that a diaper? You know, the best part about the special place called trash can is there's not just one. There are trash cans everywhere. I'm the human dislike button, and I believe in you. I believe in your ability to find a trash can. To learn more about me, go to breck.org/HDB.
Welcome back to Weekends with Whitney. Time now to head to the country for a daydream. A camel. Kangaroo. Sloth. Deer.
ducks, reptiles, bunnies, chicks, silky chickens. Horses and ponies that grant wishes. They're just a few of the surprises for children in the battle of their lives, fighting cancer. St. Jude Dream Day is one day out of the year. They get to forget all about their medical condition and just be a kid. Started 22 years ago when one child with cancer just wanted to come out here fishing. And now, any kid getting treatment for cancer can come and enjoy this day too. Three buses filled with children came this year. They're VIPs, escorted by a police motorcade. I got to go 300 feet up in the air.
Wow.
For a bird's eye view of the fun ahead. John and Marty Inquist say it seems like just yesterday when they opened their Clinton Ranch for that first child.
Marty and I happened to be up here when the child came to go fishing, met him and his parents, and we were just so impressed with him and the parents and the way they were dealing with a really tough situation. So, you know, next year I think we had three or four different kids come up, and it snowballed into us creating, a group of us creating a foundation and starting this thing, and today it's developed into this.
Kids here have access to 1,700 acres. There's everything for the kids to do. It is a dream day for these St. Jude patients.
See, you know, it's awesome. And, you know, we see these kids that, you know, started here 22 years ago. They're married with children.
Jason Swartz is one of them. At 13, he was diagnosed with leukemia.
I think the first year that I came here was in 1996. So after I had gotten through the hard part of therapy in the late 95, I came here in 1996. I think that was the second year maybe.
Yeah.
And so it was just me and another patient, Danny Bozeman. I think we were one of the two people that were the original comers of Dream Day. So it's a special, special day for everyone, but certainly holds a special place in my heart.
Now, Dr. Swartz. Is a pediatric oncologist working as a fellow in Memphis at St. Jude Hospital.
Is that why you went to med school? Because
It is exactly why I went to med school.
Really?
My experience at St. Jude in retrospect was a really positive one. There were hard times, you know, there was sucky parts of it all, but it really instilled a curiosity in me, and I thought that I had something to offer, so I really made it a focus to try to one day get back there, and I've been really fortunate to get back there.
Miracles happen at St. Jude, and they've made such incredible strides in dealing with these catastrophic childhood diseases that were, you know, a virtual death sentence when St. Jude opened.
The survival rate for the leukemia Dr. Swartz had is now 95%, but numbers for other childhood cancers are much lower.
unfortunately, many of the other diseases have much less success rate, and that's why St. Jude is really pushing forward with research and discovery to try to make all of the different types of cancers as you know, a survival rate as good as leukemia.
So in addition to giving St. Jude children and their families everything here today, the Dream Day Foundation also donates up to $500,000 a year for research.
Hopefully one day it'll make Danny's dream come true that no child should die in the dawn of life.
Children symbolized in these balloons. Each one released represents a child who died this year of cancer. Here they dream of the day there will be no more balloons. If you'd like to volunteer or just get more information, head to dreamdayfoundation.org. And still ahead, Dr. Nick shares invaluable insight on how to prevent divorce from becoming a wrecking ball in your life as Weekends with Whitney continues.
Maggio, the only way to go. Maggio Buick GMC. Satisfaction's our specialty. We really deliver on Fault River here in New Roads. Small town atmosphere, legendary service for over 60 years. Maggio, the only way to go. The only way to go, that's Maggio.
9-time winner of the prestigious Buick GMC Mark of Excellence Award. It will happen to 50% of everyone we know. Divorce. It can be crushing, it can be devastating, and in some instances, it can be liberating. But Dr. Nick joins us this morning with more. It's not just the couple going through the divorce, it's everyone around them, right?
Everyone.
Extended families, co-workers, children, it is. And you deal with it a lot, which is why we decided to bring this topic up.
I do. I deal a lot with couples going through it. I deal a lot with couples who are struggling and discerning whether they can stay. Mm. I deal a lot with people who are going through it and just trying to help them understand the most important thing about divorce is your entire world is shattered. Mm. The whole world is shattered. Everything around you has now died.
That's
and it's the
tragic.
It's a brutal form of betrayal, especially when it's unexpected. Mm. Now, when you're struggling for 2 to 3 years and you divorce, yes, your world crumbles, but it's different than when you think everything is fine, and the husband says, I don't love you anymore, or I want a divorce, or the wife says,
sure,
which is a pretty good strong percentage of that too. I don't know what the numbers are, but I do know what happens, and that's the real nuclear option, if you will.
Yeah,
it's pushing the button.
You've dealt with patients like that before. How do you say that? How do you help put the pieces back together for someone who has just been shocked and shattered by divorce? Because I think those are the people who don't want to get out of bed and who cry incessantly and who just, what do you do?
Well, you almost have to do two things at one time. And I hope that there are people going through it listening. There must be the pain.
Oh, they know there's pain.
Well, but we want to avoid it. We want to take something, or we want to see, okay, how long will it last? Or what can I do to get out of it? Well, there's really nothing you can do to get out of it. You have to hurt.
You can't drink it away. You can't sleep it away.
You can't drug it away. You can't sleep it. You can't. I'm not anti-medication for people who can't stop crying. I mean, and might need a little help with cutting it. But there must be the pain. This is truly death. This is death. And in many ways, it's worse than death because you know the other person is alive.
And sometimes very well. And very, happy.
And maybe
and
happy.
And you're miserable.
Yeah, but again, we don't know that.
Sure.
The divorced person experiences that as that way and perceives it as that way, but I'm not so sure about it. Mm. But I think there's something else that's going on with me, and I have to be very careful with this because I'm not anti-religion. I get very concerned with the way religion sometimes treats divorce.
Really? For
Christianity. Yeah.
Tell me
it's
how.
A second class. It's second class. It's you know, are you getting an annulment? It's like that. That's the first thing. That's not anywhere near priority for people who are going through a divorce. They're already feeling shamed enough.
Right.
They're already feeling poor enough. Let's not keep building on it. People who are going through divorce need a safe place to go, and churches you would think would be the safest. But part of the problem is you've gone to that church together. So now what do you do?
Right.
But we're talking about, again, a loss of one's world. Mm-hmm. And don't you feel sometimes, don't you hear sometimes people, I'm divorced,
so
I just don't know where I stand with the church and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, you got much bigger fish to fry than to be worrying about, you know, what an autocratic society might be thinking of you. Because there are a lot of couples in those pews that beat each other all the time. And I don't think that that's very loving.
Right.
And pardon me, I'm not, again, I know this world.
Right.
I really hurt for people. You know people who've gone through it.
Oh.
All we can do is say you're going to hurt. But here's the other side of it real quick. I was saying that it's almost contradictory. In the midst of the world shattering, what you have to do is rebuild a world. You have to start over.
That's the hard part.
That's the hard part. You got to go by the plant and water it and say it will live. You got to maybe redo whatever you can with whatever limited resources you have. And I think, again, I don't want to knock attorneys either. This is not my style. You want a civil divorce. You don't want it to be a war.
And
too often it is a war. And there are too many people in the legal world who somehow maybe can get caught up in thinking that they're your advocate, but not understanding that real advocacy is trying to make this as civil and as fair as possible without any emotional, I'm going to get you back.
Right. And that comes from
pain.
That's
hard.
Which is what we've talked about.
Of course it does.
Sometimes it's not really that, I mean, they're hurt and they're angry, but they're in pain and they want you to feel that pain, right?
Yes. Revenge is such a strong emotion when there's that kind of divorce or a third party or whatever.
I saw recently where people are really trying to get divorcing or divorced couples to come together for the welfare of the children, that we know the scars and the pain that it does with children. You know, you could go back generations and look to people and it was devastating for them.
Yes.
And can people look in the best interest of the children to try to be more civil?
Or I think they not only can, I think they not only can, but I think that there's a moral obligation to do that. See, that's where divorce, especially if there's children involved, we have to move beyond our sense of betrayal and revenge to think about what's in the best welfare of the children. You know, to constantly berate the former wife or the former husband in front of the children. That's their mother.
And then,
that's their father.
And then they internalize it
and
because that's part of them.
And they will internalize it. And then you can lead to parenting alienation, which gets us in a whole nother horrible bag of worms because I can't stand that. Let's take the betrayal, take the revenge, take the pain, take every bit of it to heart and say, yes, this is what I'm going through.
Okay.
But there's one last thing that we need very be very careful of.
Tell me.
I'm not going to beat myself up.
Blame
myself as an idiot. How did I not know? Right? Self-hatred. And I'm not going to hate my partner because we were together for 20 years. We've got some good memories. It's not all bad. I wouldn't have chose him or her. Does that make sense? We can't just throw away those years. We have to say thank you for that. Not necessarily to the person, but
sure.
To life. And then we're into that kind of reframe mold. The world's falling apart, but we're going to rebuild it, and we're going to rebuild it with good memories.
I see.
It's challenging.
Yes.
I know.
For some of my friends who have gone through it, the part that just broke my heart was they felt so unlovable. And I'm, yes. You know, there are only so many things, yes. which brings me to a point.
Yes, well said.
Groups.
Wish we had more of them. I know what there's.
Are they great for people going through a divorce?
They're great. I've led many, many divorce groups.
I remember one of our friends, Cindy. She said you saved her.
I've done many divorce groups because you're able to be with people and have cathartic experiences, but also hopefully have a facilitator that's going to try to move you beyond just let's sit here and the eight of us talk about how horrible our ex-spouses were.
Right.
That won't get to us.
No.
That won't get us to another place. We have to go through again the darkness. And there is a certain ownership of what I did. Maybe. I may have been a part of it. I don't think I ever caused someone to go do something. But I think, you know, we dance the dance. And so there's a facing of what role I may have played, but not a shaming. It's more of how do we pick it back up and reinvest? It's not only hard, but it's imperative. Mm-hmm. It's imperative, especially if there's children. It's imperative that life go on.
Right.
And by the way, if I just real quick.
Please.
I've seen more resurrections post-divorce than you can imagine. There is life beyond divorce. There is life beyond divorce.
Great, thanks.
And the world needs to hear it.
Yeah, you're right. Thanks so much, Dr. Nick.
Happy Sunday. And if anyone's struggling, get some help.
Yeah. More Weekends with Whitney after this.
Atlas Foundation Repair, fixing your foundation problems for more than 30 years while preserving and protecting your trees.
Thanks for joining us. Hope to see you back here again next week. Until then, you can follow us on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram. Until then, we leave you with this.
I'm so caught up in you, little girl.